morning, everyone. Can you all hear me? It doesn't have to be quite so close, Johnny. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Gilgal. It's lovely to see you all. Even though the weather's not great, you've made it through the bad weather to get here, and it's lovely to have you back with us. And this morning, I've got a few announcements that I'm going to run past everyone, just to make you aware of some of the stuff that's kind of happening, and then we'll go on to a prayer, and then after that, we'll go into our first song. Okay, so this morning then, I want to welcome Reverend Peter Idris Taylor. Welcome back to Gilgal. It's lovely to have you with us. I'm sure everyone this morning is really looking forward to what's going to be said and learn and come and know God a bit more. I also want to kind of point out that the first, like, our oldest group is going into the kitchen, and I know we're going to be doing teas and coffees later, but if you can, for the time being, try not to go in there before the end of the service, just because we're doing alpha with them, and it's kind of really good for them to kind of be aware of stuff, and we get really into it, and yeah, if you can wait a few minutes, that would be really, really helpful for us. Also, thank you to every single person that put their name down to volunteer and help us do the halls, like redecorating. I know we've got a little bit of a wait yet before we can get in there, but thank you ever so much. Like, the amount of people that have put their names down, we are so, so grateful for every single one of you. So thank you for that. I know we've got a little bit of a wait, but soon we'll get cracking with that. It'll be lovely to kind of work with you all and get to know you all a little bit better. So I am looking forward to kind of partnering with everybody as we start decorating together. Okay, lastly, we are doing teas and coffee, so if you are new, it would be lovely for you to stay with us, kind of get to know people. The tea and coffee is good, and now I'm hearing that there is biscuits as well, so please stick around and have a refreshment at the end. I think that's it for announcements. There's nothing else. One more, we've written a prayer diary for the children's work, kind of what's happening. If you can, you know, if you've got time, please take one with you just to keep in your Bible. You know, we do appreciate all prayers for our young people, you know, and all the work that me and Owen are doing. You know, we really do need your prayers with that. So if you can, I know that they're all with Linda at the front. Please don't hesitate to pick one up. If you feel you've got time to lend us a prayer or two, that would be really, really great. Okay, let us pray. Let's start the day by praying. Okay, so thank you, Lord God, that we can come to you no matter where we are or what the weather is like. Thank you that you are our God and that every day your love and mercy is never failing. Thank you for getting us through another week, that even though we have may face trials or at times maybe been discouraged, that we can now come before you together as a family and just praise you for your goodness. We pray your hand over this morning's service, that the Holy Spirit will fill this place, and that each one of us, no matter where we are in this building, will be renewed by your presence and your message. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, our first song is We Want to See Jesus Lifted High. So I am going to ask you to kind of stand. So most of you probably know this song. If you want to kind of clap along, please feel free to do that. But I'll leave it over to Shirley to kind of get that started. Thank you.
Jesus lifted. Jesus told his disciples that we're to go into the world, we're to make disciples, we're to baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. This is what we're to do. Every believer is under this commission. We're to share the good news. There's Holy Spirit-filled power in the gospel. There's power in that message, the power to save sinners. The ultimate goal for every believer is to share their faith and to lead someone to faith in Jesus Christ. We want the world to know that there's a God, that He loves them, cares for them. You see, the Bible says all of us have sinned. We've all come short of God's standards, but yet God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but should have that everlasting life. Let's work together to proclaim this gospel, to evangelize another generation.
So as a church, we're strongly advocating in taking part in this event. In fact, we're encouraging people to go on the Christian Life and Witness courses, which are running throughout February and March. And there are sign-up sheets for those in the foyer. So you can either sign up to say you'd like to go but need a lift, or you can sign up to say which one you're going to and you can offer a lift. It's up to you. Just have a look at those sign-up sheets in the foyer. And of course, the whole thing culminates in an event at the ICC in Newport on Saturday the 21st of May at 7 p.m. We're encouraging you to start now to think who you could take along to that event. And in fact, there is a pledge card, I am Andrew, which we're encouraging you to take and sign. Andrew brought his brother Peter to Jesus. And we're asking you to commit to pray, to talk about church, your Christian life, and then take somebody along to the Graham Franklin mission afterwards. So these cards and the dates of the Christian Life and Witness, they're all available in the foyer from Gordon at the end of the service.
You've got to go to us. You're with us in Hasn't read the Torah.
Truly, I tell you, no prophet is accepted in his hometown.
We're late.
Don't you complain when you're the one who kept stopping for lunch and morning tea and rest breaks and dessert and... I'm sorry, man. I know this was important to you.
Hang on.
Levi, if you're afraid of heights, raise your hand.
What? Yay!
Ivy!
Surely you will quote this proverb to me. Physician, heal yourself. And you will tell me, do hear in your hometown what we have heard.
What?
Truly. Look!
Hey, look out!
What are you doing?
When the sky was what? Friend, your sins are forgiven.
Forgiving sins? Who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy?
Which is easier to say? Your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? Get up, take your mat, and go home.
Our Old Testament reading is from the book of Haggai, chapter 2, verses 1 to 9. On the 21st day of the seventh month, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Speak to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, to Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people. Ask them, who of you is left who saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? But now be strong, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord, and work, for I am with you, declares the Lord Almighty. This is what I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, and my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land. I will shake all nations, and what is desired by all nations will come. And I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. The glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Lord Almighty. And in this place I will grant peace, declares the Lord Almighty. And we turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 23. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Amen.
Let's join together in prayer. We've got a Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to speak to us from it day by day. We know that it connects with us in a way that nothing else does. We thank you that you speak through your written word. But we thank you too, Lord, for sending your living word. And we pray that you will help us to understand the connections between what we see written on a page and the experience of the living Christ. Lord, enlighten our hearts today. May your voice be heard above all other voices. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A Welsh chapel was being redecorated, renovated, and the final touch was to replace the elaborate frontpiece. They used to find in old chapels, I don't know if it's the case in Gilboa, where they would have a verse or something written in the front, like across the thing. Anyway, in this particular church, the chapel, they had this elaborate frontpiece, and it was the sign writer had been working on it. The church secretary turned up just to have a look to see how things were going, and he looked up at the scrolls, the gold details, thought really elaborate, but then he read the text, "Cymru am byth," Wales forever. The church said, "That's really beautiful, but we were hoping for something a bit more religious." "Well, come back tomorrow," said the painter. So on the following day, the church secretary remained and returned, and he looked back up at that text, and he read it. It was in Welsh, but it read, "Wales forever and ever. Amen." I'm sure that many of you are looking forward to moving back into Gilgal. The time this whole development has been talked about and planned seems like forever. But when we think of what you are going through and what the Jews in the time of Haggai were going through, well, let me tell you, if you thought it was taking a long time, the ancient Jews who had seen their beloved temple, the one built by Solomon, destroyed by the Babylonians, the key leaders of their community had been carried off into what is now Iraq. Then 47 years after that, the Babylonians had been conquered by the Persians from modern day Iran. And this led to a chance for some of the Jews to return to Jerusalem with Ezra, and work had started rebuilding the temple. But work had not got very far. And it was now 15 or 16 years later, and the temple was still a half-finished mess. And there were some people who remembered the heyday of the temple, the splendor of Solomon's temple. And to them, this new temple was, well, it was not a patch on the old one. And then the Lord said to Haggai, ask them, who of you is left who saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? And there were two generations that saw things with different sets of eyes. The youngsters were very excited at the prospect of a new temple and all that they could do there. All right, it was smaller than the first one and nowhere near as elaborate, but they were keen to see the work progress. But then there were older members of the community able to remember the temple of 66 years ago. And they may have even, some people have been younger, but they've been told by their parents how wonderful it all was. And they looked at this replacement and were so disappointed with it all. They were disheartened by the work being done around them. It may even have been that disheartenment that led to a lack of support, and that in turn brought things to a halt. But God's concern was not so much with what was or what is, but with what he was about to do, what he was about to do. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land. I will shake all nations, and what is desired by all nations will come, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. God's message was to get ready for him. God was about to do something to restore that nation, and over the next 500 years, the people would gather regularly at this renewed temple. But instead of it now being the focus of a small nation, this new revelation would take the message of the Lord to all the nations of the world. And so Isaiah would record God saying about this temple, his temple, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Gone are the days when the temple was a physical symbol of God's presence to a small neighborhood or single nation. God's vision is for the entire world. Now, one of the effects of the pandemic is that churches that previously never considered recording or broadcasting their services online have now been doing so regularly. In a survey last year, 74% of Southwest Baptist churches responding to the survey indicated that they were now using some form of digital ministry, and we welcome those that are watching online today. Churches are reporting that new attendees are turning up online before they turn up in person. To those people in Jerusalem who were daunted by the prospect of doing something new, rebuilding the temple, the prophet told them that God was with them, and there were resources for the job that seemed so impossible. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. The glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Lord Almighty. To be told that the glory of the present house would be greater than the glory of the former house seemed hard to swallow. As I say, some people could still remember the good old days when the temple was in superb condition and the crowds flocked there to worship. And even for those who were too young to remember those days, the temple in its present condition seemed so unfinished, so neglected almost, even in the process of refurbishment and rebuilding. And the idea that things could be better in the future than they were in the past seemed highly fanciful and optimistic. God, who sees the past, the present, and the future in a single glance, was not caught out by COVID-19. And he sees great potential here for Gilgore to become a hub for Christian training and mission, not just for Port Paul, but for maybe a 10-mile half radius. You may find that people from 10 miles away won't travel quite this far, but you could work in partnership with sister churches as far afield as Maesteg or Port Talbot or the whole of Bridgend County. Can't see it? Well, a lot of people couldn't imagine the second temple being greater than Solomon's temple. But God promised the glory would be greater. He went on to say, "And in this place, I will grant peace, declares the Lord Almighty." Peace is one of the greatest gifts that God can give to the human heart. To be able to sleep at night without worrying about what you are facing in the morning. To be able to open a bank statement without trembling. To know that God loves you no matter what circumstances you find yourself in. And since Jesus died on the cross to save us from our sins and our own failures, we know that with Jesus as our Savior, we are treated by God as if we are already saved from the effects of sin. Bottom line, left to our own devices, our minds sometimes take us to places we'd rather not go. We remember some of the mistakes that we've made, the bad choices, the way we treated some people, the way we behaved towards others. And we don't need other people to tell us that we are sinners. We tell ourselves that often enough. And peace comes when we accept that Jesus has done everything necessary to take away our sins. And although we still live with the the memories and some of the effects of these mistakes and these sins, God will not hold them against us. So why then do we keep holding them against ourselves? Peace comes when we fully accept what Jesus has done for us. What was the first thing that Jesus said to his disciples after his resurrection? What did he say to Simon Peter, who had denied him, or the others that had run away? It's recorded in John chapter 20. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." He gives us peace because he died and was resurrected. And our sins are not held against us anymore. He gives us a purpose. "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." Our mission is to help others experience the Prince of Peace. He gives us a partner, the Holy Spirit, who enables us to carry out the mission of God. He gives us the power to let people know about Jesus. And when they accept him as their Lord and Savior, we are able to say to them, to declare to them, that their sins are forgiven. And we need people to carry that message to us, to speak on God's behalf. If we don't share the gospel of forgiveness, the gospel of peace, who can? Is that going to be the Senate, the UK government, Mark Drakeford or Boris Johnson? Are they carriers of peace? Well, Gilgal is not just a local church. It is a house of prayer for all nations, for all ethnic groups, for all nationalities. It's to be an environment in which God the Holy Spirit will gather people to experience his love, to experience the peace of God, to learn more about him, and to respond through worship and through service or ministry. It's a place where we can be equipped and resourced to take the gospel of peace both within and beyond. Quoth Paul. The Celtic of Flann, which is in many place names, was a enclosed center where there was often a church, but also places where people could live and work. And it was where people could gather for training and refreshment so that they could go out from the Flann to new areas, taking the good news of God's peace. And then after they'd been out on this mission trip, they were able to return to the Flann and be refreshed and renewed before then going out again on more mission trips. Now, each Christian is now a temple of the Holy Spirit. And each church, each gathering, is also a temple of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes it doesn't come across so much in English. It's better in American, because where it says in one part, "You are a temple of the Holy Spirit individually," in another place it says, "Y'all," you plural. the T in Welsh, rather than the P. And it's this this understanding that each church, each individual, but each church is a temple of the Holy Spirit. And we have been given this commission. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they're not forgiven. We carry the message of peace and forgiveness with us wherever we go. When someone opens their minds and hearts to all that Jesus has for them and accepts his free gift of salvation, we can declare your sins are forgiven. And that's a wonderful thing to be able to say to someone, isn't it? And in this way, and at this time, God will rebuild his temple so that new generations from all over the world will find God and be granted peace. God has already started moving, but there's so much more to come. And so let's be open to all that God has planned for you and for the temple of the Holy Spirit that meets in Gilmore. And in this place, I will grant peace, declares the Lord Almighty. Let's join together in prayer. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for those that brought the gospel of peace to us. We pray that you will continue to speak to each and every one of us, so that we in turn will have the sensitivity to see and understand where the Holy Spirit is already at work. Lord, give us the courage to share the good news. And we pray to you, Lord, that you will give us the authority to be able to speak on your behalf, so that when people just turn towards you, that we will be able to say to them, your sins are forgiven. And Lord, we pray for all that's coming to pass very quickly now. We pray, Lord, for the mission and the training for that mission with Franklin Graham. We pray, Lord, for the finishing off, so that once again the congregation can return to Gilmore. But Lord, we pray that you will never let them be stopped by those walls, but help them to see beyond them to all that you are doing within this land and this town at this time. Lord, we pray for those who are not able to be with us in person. We pray particularly for those who are feeling sick, those who are looking after people that are feeling unwell. We pray for those that are still affected by this COVID pandemic. We pray, Lord, that you will be with them wherever they are, and that they may sense your presence and your peace, even as they watch the service today. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done. We thank you for all that you're doing, and we look forward to all that you are yet to do. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to conclude our service this morning by singing this great, great hymn, In Christ Alone.
What gets up?
Continue through this day, we pray, Lord, that you will keep us close to you. Help us to have that sense of your presence. Give us the courage to behave, knowing that you are standing alongside us. And Lord, we pray that you will help us to speak authoritatively on your behalf. Lord, we pray once again that you will pour out your Holy Spirit on this land of Wales and the UK and the whole of Europe as well. And we need a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We need a new touch from you so that others will come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. Now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.